Jack's Janitorial Services, locally owned, providing cleaning services for businesses, churches, and homes, including the safe and effective cold water fogging to eliminate any potential of coronavirus. Call Jack today and see how affordable his services are. That's at 434-444-1882.
Caring for my own grandmother gave me a passion for extending that same assistance and peace of mind to others. When I discovered that I could have a caring career as a visiting angel, I was certain I had found the right place for me. With Visiting Angels, I know I'll receive the encouragement needed to be the best caregiver possible. Visiting Angels isn't just a job, it's a fulfilling and natural part of my life.
Visiting Angels, America's choice in home care.
And hello, everyone. I'm so glad that you've joined us today on The Viewpoint. And I pray that your heart will be mightily blessed on the program as we're going to delve into God's Word and talk today about Ephesians 1, 1 and 2, and how it's important today that we place God in the proper position of our lives and that we serve Him, live for Him, and love Him, and make Him first. My name is Carlton Duck. I'm pastor of Gethsemane Baptist Church in Lynchburg. Such a pleasure to be with you, and I pray this program is an encouragement to your heart and a great blessing to your life. It's an honor to bring you the Word of God each week through Alive TV and Gethsemane Baptist Church. Our location is very easy to find here in Lynchburg, a great church that you will really enjoy the people, the worship, and just the climate of worship that is in this church is extraordinary. And we're located at 411 Blue Ridge Street here in Lynchburg. Not hard to find, one block off of Lakeside Drive. We're near the main entrance to the University of Lynchburg, and your heart will be greatly blessed. Two worship opportunities, 9:30 a.m. and 11:30 a.m. on Sunday morning right now, because we're still in the pandemic and we're taking all precautions to give you a very safe worship environment, not only from the cleaning aspect, but we use a process that is called cold water fogging, that each week sanctuary in our building is fogged, and it provides a very safe environment. And I want to encourage you to come and experience the great things that God's doing in this ministry. This Sunday would be a great time. Now, there's a couple other things I just want to bring to your attention. I want you to visit us on a couple other sites, and you can actually go to one and get to the other. So I'm going to tell you first about AliveGBC.com. AliveGBC.com. That's our website. You can go to that and get a wealth of information and be blessed. And it's all current, updated daily, and you'll be blessed by it. There is a place that you can click on, and you can go to YouTube of some of the programs and things that we're doing here at Gethsemane and some of our previous church programs. Additionally, there's another click on that you can click on to Facebook. It'll take you directly to my Facebook page, and there you can gain even additional information and see some of the things that we're doing each week, such as every Wednesday at 5 p.m., we do a program that is called Ask Me Anything. And right now we're on a prophecy series. Your questions are sent to me by different means, messenger, emails, or texting, or whatever the whatever works for you. I take those questions, and then I look deep into the pages of God's Word, and then we answer those questions on air. So anyway, we hope that you can be a part of that great Bible study, and you can go back and look at it at any time. It's on, of course, our Facebook page for you to peruse through, look at, and enjoy. So anyway, thank you again for tuning into this program and being a part of what God's doing in this ministry. And today, I'd like for you to turn in your Bibles, if you have your Bibles, and if not, just follow along. We only have two verses that we're really going to absorb today, and that's from the book of Ephesians chapter 1. I believe the biggest obstacle to anyone that says all paths leads to God and all religions are the same, Jesus does not agree with that statement. You realize no other founder of any other faith has ever claimed to be who Jesus claimed to be and who he is, and what he can do. We know the Word of God today reminds us with the Lord, nothing is impossible. I don't care how bad your life is. I don't care how much you've sinned. I don't care how much you've turned away from God. I'm telling you, His mercy is available. His forgiveness is available. His grace is sufficient to save you today, and He can turn your life around. So Jesus is the only one who claimed to be the Son of God and claimed to be God in the flesh, what we know as God incarnate. So He's the only founder of any faith who accepts worship of His followers. Therefore, today we can worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. He's the only one today who claims that He died not for Himself, but He died for sinners. He died for the sins of the entire world. And He's made a way that we can come to Him, and that's through the atoning blood that He shed on the cross for you and I. No one has ever claimed to live a perfect sinless life, but Jesus did. So therefore today, Jesus has performed miracles like healing the sick and raising the dead and turning water into wine and touching eyes and making them to see and giving life to limbs and just bringing back from the dead. I mean, it's amazing what our God has done. Christianity alone is centered on a person. That person is the one that went to the cross. That person is the one who died for us. That person is the one that is seated at God's right hand, who is our intercessor and our provider. That one is Jesus Christ, the King of glory. Now, let's look at Ephesians 1, and I'll just read it to you. Ephesians 1, 1 and 2. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus, grace be to you, and peace from God and our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I think you would have to agree with me that we live and work today and exist in a society that is absolutely honeycombed today with corruption, pornography, and lies, and our society has moved further and further away from God. If you don't believe that, just look what's happening in our world. Look what's happening in this upcoming election that we've got. Look at the moral decline in our nation. Look at today the things and the rioting and the chaos and the confusion and the anarchy that is happening in our streets. Just look at the condition of our nation. Who would have ever thought that we would come to this? Our society is not today on an incline today of improving. I hate to say it today, but recently it's been on a decline into the very abyss. I'm telling you folks that today is the fact that people is they don't love God, they don't regard God, they don't respect God, they have no reverence for God. And that's our problem, which all comes back to the core of the problem. It's a sin problem. And that's exactly at the very center of why we are what we are today. So we read that the institution of marriage, it continues to lose ground. Divorces are on the rise. Broken homes, shattered homes, drugs, all the craziness is going on. Methamphetamines. Today, the many things that we're facing today, children are more wayward, Christians are less committed, and churches are crumbling. And I'm not talking today about the physical church as far as the building. I'm talking about the people. They've lost focus. And then the last, 9, 10 months, we've just really seen this today come to the forefront of Christians crumbling and no longer trusting God. We have become controlled by a pandemic. We've been controlled by what we're hearing from the social, the media and the social media today. We're believing everything that we hear. Why don't we try believing God and what God has said about us today? There is no Christian majority in America today. There's really no voice for America today in the ranks of the church except the church and the church that stands for Christ. And honestly, that's what we need. We need today churches today to stand up for the principles of God's Word and start not just proclaiming it, but I believe the greatest evidence that we have is that we live it. we live the glorious gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Ephesians, Paul calls us not to look at the surrounding society so much, but he says, it's time to look to the God of the universe. I've got to agree with that. Who else do we have to look to? God has solutions. Man has ideas and opinions, but man does not understand truth. God is truth, and they that follow him follow the truth of God's word, and their lives are changed. See, your life can be changed today, too. Are you confused by all the bobbing, talking heads of news media and politicians and all the things and the buzz that we hear? You know, folks, I've got to be honest with you. It is just nauseating today to see what is happening in our nation, in our world, and the political environment that we're living in, and just the malice and the feelings and the lies. Oh, listen, I'm glad I can open God's Word, and I can come to the house of the Lord, and I can hear the truth of God's Word that encourages me, that liberates me, that strengthens my life, that encourages my heart. That's what I'm looking for. And that's what makes me be able to lay down at night, pillow my head, close my eyes, and sleep with peace and comfort, and knowing my God, the God of the universe, the God who is sovereign, the God who sits on the throne, the God that possesses all power, the very God who has all wisdom and knowledge and understanding, that God is in control. And what's even more encouraging to my heart, not only is he all of that and so much more, but this God loves me as he loves you, as he loves all people, and he wants to be our God. But we've got to make a step by faith to God for God today to really to grant us his favor. So I really believe today that Paul was writing to a group of believers there in Ephesus who were living in pagan Ephesus. And Paul warns the believers that basically all around them was a culture that was calling their attention and grasping their focus, and realizing that you need to get your eyes off of the fool's goal of this world, as we need to get our eyes off of this world. And as the writer of Hebrews tells us, we need to look to Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. And we've got to put our eyes upon the riches that we have in Christ. Do you realize, as a Christian, Paul said in the book of Romans that we're heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus. We are believers. We are followers. We are belonging to the Lord through the process of salvation. So Paul is pulling our face today up for us to look up to God today and realize that he wants our attention today on God, the sovereign God, the almighty God, the everlasting God, the all-powerful God, the God in whom there is no weakness. Today, the all-knowing God, the life-changing God. You've got to get your attention today on him, because he's the only one that can make the difference in your life. So today, the problem with the church today is that the church of today is focusing on man and the world and not God. We want church today to look so worldly that you can't tell the difference between church and the world. No, that's not the way it should be. We're standard setters. We are to be the example. We are to be the reflector of the love of God. So the church is not to be a church today that is focusing today on the methods of man. You've got to put your attention, your focus, your heart, your life, your family on Christ. Oh, what a difference he'll make if we will simply learn to look to him, trust in him, believe on him, and live for him. Now, Ephesians is like it's kind of like a pot scrubbing pad. It's small, but it's very effective and it's very cleansing. We need today the cleansing of God's Word to go into the depths of our heart and our life and our soul, and today cleanse us and purify us. I've said it before, I'm going to say it again, not to be repetitious, but I believe this today. I believe the key to America, the key today to the church, it's got to start at the house of God. Remember, the Word of God says judgment begins where? At the house of God. And so therefore, that means today, if judgment begins with us, it means we have got to get back, listen to me, to repentance. We've got to be a repentant people. Yes, preacher, I know this bunch out in the world, they sure do need to repent. I'm telling you, we need to repent. We need to get our hearts, our lives, our families back on the altar of service to God and start living for God and being the people that God has called us to be. We need a cleansing, a purifying. We need the Spirit of God to go into the depths of our soul and cleanse us. I'm glad if we will confess our sins. He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Aren't you glad that we have that promise from God? That's what we need. We've got to repent. We've got to come back. We've got to turn back to God. And today, folks, whoever is in Washington, who's ever in the Senate, the Congress, and the White House, let me tell you what. Their term is temporary. God's term is not temporary. God is forever. He is a God who today has not lost control. He's a God today who is in complete control, and He's the only solution that we've got, and He's the only solution that we need. So today, what do we do, Pastor? Well, we just really need today to let the Word of God get down to the depths of our soul today and cleanse and get all the filthiness out of our heart and minds and souls and our being today. And the Word of God will not only cleanse you, but you know what else the Word of God will do? It will build you up. It will strengthen you. It will encourage you today. It will fill you with the fullness of Christ that today He desires to fill you with today, that the Spirit of God will be taking over every part. See, Christianity is just not a Sunday thing. It's an every minute of the day thing. Every second, you belong to Christ. So if you away from God, the Word of God wants to bring you back. And maybe you're watching this program today and you've drifted away from God, out of church, out of the Word, out of prayer. I encourage you today, why don't you just ask God to deal with your heart and that you can come back to Him and let Him restore you today as only He can do. It will take the focus off of you and get your focus off of the world and get your focus on Christ. Oh, what a difference it makes when you put Christ first and foremost in your life. In Ephesians, Paul brings us face to face with God and realizing with the one who can do all things. Listen, one day we will stand before Him. But Paul is bringing us before God. And in Ephesians, we see the glory of God. We not only see the glory of God, but we see the greatness of God. And understand there would never be any salvation if God had not planned it and put it into execution. So you realize today, God saw man in his sinfulness. He, of course, knew what Adam and Eve had sinned and come short, as we too. Let's just not blame Adam and Eve. If you were there, I were there, we would have done the same thing. And realize that we all fall short, as Paul tells us in Romans. We've all missed that mark. We all fall short, fail. Whatever the word you want to use. But see, God has made a means of redemption, a means of forgiveness, a means of mercy, a means of pardon for us today. Even Jesus would tell us today that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. So realizing that today, who you are in Christ determines how you're going to live in the world. Let me say that again. You might want to jot that down and put it in some conspicuous place to remind you every day. Who you are in Christ determines how you live in the world. Who you are for Christ determines how you will live in the world. Several things we're going to just talk about over the remaining time that we've got. When are we in Christ? What happens is when we're in Christ, we are radically different. We're not the same anymore. I hope that's happened. And of course, 2 Corinthians tells us that therefore, if any man be in Christ, or person be in Christ, they're a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. So Paul has been liberated from the crushing bonds of sin and the chains and the shackles of himself and the world. And realizing today he was dead and now he's alive. Same thing happened to you and I. God has not changed His plan of salvation. God has not changed redemption. God's way is still God's way. And so you realize that where he was Saul of Tarsus, God not only changed his name, God changed his life. Now he's Paul the Apostle. He is radically different. And I use that word radically different because, you know, a lot of Christians, they say, well, I'm saved and that's about it. If Christ has worked salvation in your life, you are radically changed. You are radically different. You are not the same person. And folks, if you really want to see that exemplified in your life, start serving God, start reading His Word and praying and living for Him and get in church. And realize today that Christ has changed us, not the world, not a preacher, no person. Christ has changed us today. So only the gospel can change a person. The gospel, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. Only this gospel can change you today. Only the gospel can take a dead sinner and make them alive unto Christ. And you who were dead in sins, Christ has quickened, Paul said, or made us alive in Himself. So if you're saved, you should be living a radically different life because you belong to God. And if you belong to God, that means you're different. That means that you, instead of turning on the TV set and listening to these folks, and there's some other words I could use, but I won't, these folks going at it and the news media trying to slant your thoughts and all the other things that are happening, you open the Word of God and you read about the God who loves you, prepared a place for you, is coming for you, and supplies and sustains and provides for you every day. I'm going to tell you, that's a lot better to receive into your spirit than what the world is trying to put into your mind to distort your thinking on God. So if you're saved, you need to be radically different because you belong to God. Therefore today, Paul said to in Galatians, he says, God called him by His grace. And you know what grace, the acrostic for grace, is God's riches at Christ's expense. And so He has called us today, and He has a plan. Listen, He has a plan for your life as He has a plan for my life. You've got to determine and discover the plan that God has for your life and then start living that life for His glory. So therefore today, secondly, when we are in Christ, we are intensely focused. We're living in a time where people are just, their minds are distorted. Their minds are confused. Their life is confused. And so Paul was an apostle in Christ, and it was all because of the will of God that had been worked in his life. Paul was so focused that he said in 1 Corinthians 9, he says, woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. There's a compelling thing within, just like Jeremiah said of old. He said, there's a fire burning in my bones. So Paul is an apostle of Jesus Christ. And notice the force behind it. He said, by the will of God. It was God's will that he be that. That's God's will today that you serve him in whatever the capacity that he has designed for your life. God has written the book of your life. You just need to live it out as he's reading it to you every day. So today he had been set free. Paul had been set free as you and I are set free. And Paul was sent by God as you and I are sent by God to do a work for the kingdom of the Lord. So if you're outside of Christ today, your decision making, your choices will be shackled by the sins of this world. And that's not God's intention for your life today. You don't need to be shackled by the world. You need today to be filled with the power and the presence of God. So Paul kept the focus of who he was in Christ. You and I must keep that same focus today, belonging to Christ, to do the will of God, to keep Christ at the forefront of our lives every day. And thank God, we can be radically different and we can be intensely focused on Christ. Then third, we find in Christ, we are eternally secure. I wouldn't give you a dime for a salvation that couldn't keep you. But I'm glad today to tell you that we have a salvation that keeps us today. If you've been redeemed by Jesus Christ, you are a saint of the living God. And therefore today, a saint is someone today who's been set apart by the redemption of Christ, and we've been changed by Jesus. Thank God. That's what salvation will do for you today. Paul didn't become a saint because he decided to be one. You realize he was radically changed by Christ. He was intensely focused on Christ, and he was eternally secure in Christ. And so therefore, all these three areas then made him Three areas made him faithful to Christ. So today, listen, if you're radically changed by Christ, if you're intensely focused on Christ, and if you are eternally secure because of Christ, then today there will be faithfulness in your life to Christ. Take those three things and put them to work in your living today. Understand, God has placed you here. He's got a purpose for your life. And that purpose is not, well, I'm just trying to survive. Get that mentality out of your spirit. God didn't send you here to just survive. God has sent you here today to thrive in His presence and His power. And today, I tell you folks, we need to get our eyes off of the world and get our eyes fixed on Christ. We need to start serving this one true living God. We need to put Him first in our lives. And lastly, when we're in Christ, we're spiritually able today. Paul said, grace and peace be to you. And I'm glad today grace and peace is how the gospel works. Grace and peace today is real. It works in our lives, and grace comes first, then comes peace. Grace is the fountain. Peace is the river. And so therefore today, grace comes from God, and that grace gives us today peace with God. Peace today. Peace today that amidst all the confusion of this world, you can live in peace, a surpassing peace today. The grace of God will erase your past. Your sins are gone. The grace will enable your present, and the grace of God will energize your future to live for God. So at the cross, there's a healing for your life, and I invite you to come to that healing today, because the blood of Jesus can wash your sins, and today He can restore you, bless you, and encourage your heart when you look to Jesus, casting your every care upon Him, because He cares for you. Thank you for tuning in today, and as we close the program out, I just want to express my gratitude for you watching on live TV, also watching the programs that are on the station for you, the Gethsemane Baptist Church and many other church programs and the other things that we put on for you to watch that's family friendly and encouraging to your family today. And I want to encourage you to come worship with us at Gethsemane Baptist. We're so easily found here in Lynchburg. So convenient. 411 Blue Ridge Street in Lynchburg. That's one block off of Lakeside Drive. That's Route 221. And we're near the main entrance to what used to be Lynchburg College. Now it's the University of Lynchburg. Service times 9:30 and 11:30. We have a clean environment for you to come worship in. And we have a fantastic program for kids called the Kitty Care Kit. The kids get a package every week when they come to church, and they've got all types of information and things and projects and crafts and treats and you name it. It's all in that package for those kids, and each week they get a new one and they take it with them. What they don't do here at church, they can take it home and work on and enjoy. It is fantastic, and our kids love it. Your kids will love it too. Come worship with us and visit us at alivegbc.com. From that site, you can watch us on some YouTube videos that we have produced and programs that are in a part of our church. And also, you can go to our Facebook page and check out what's going there. So like on Wednesdays, you can watch and what the questions that we are fielding and Ask Me Anything is that series. And right now, we're dealing on prophecy. Sure glad that you have joined us in this program. Pray that your heart is blessed, your family is doing well, take care of yourself, and today keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. Thank you today. This is Carlton Duck for Viewpoint. God bless you mightily today.
Jack's Janitorial Services, locally owned, providing cleaning services for businesses, churches, and homes, including the safe and effective cold water fogging to eliminate any potential of coronavirus. Call Jack today and see how affordable his services are. That's at 434-444-1882. Robinson Funeral Home in Appomattox is a full-service, family-owned funeral home. We've been located in the Central Virginia area since 1947 to serve you. We stand ready to assist you in arranging a personalized and meaningful funeral or cremation service to memorialize your loved one, or we can help you with your pre-arrangement plans. When you need a friend, we are here for you. Robinson Funeral Home in Appomattox, Virginia.
America, my home, sweet home. God bless America again. God bless America again. You see all the trouble that she's in. Wash her pretty face, dry her eyes, and then God bless America again. God, I sure do wish you'd bless America again. You know, the way you did back when it all began. You blessed her then, Lord, but somehow we just took it for granted, and we never did ask again. So just hold her hand, God, that's all. And if she stumbles, please, don't let her fall. God bless America again. See all the trouble that she's in. Wash her pretty face, dry her eyes, and then God bless America again. Some of our people have forgotten your role in America's greatness, Lord. And honesty and character don't seem to count much with our leaders anymore. And Lord, when you were involved, America was a beacon to the world. And with your help, she can be again. So please, God, bless America again. Sing it with me. God bless America again. You see all the trouble that she's in. Wash her pretty face, dry her eyes, and then God bless America again. God bless America, land that I love. God bless America again.
To the word this morning, and please pay attention and focus upon what God has to speak to us on this very important day, and what our faith hinges upon, and what really our salvation is all about. You know, if Jesus had just died on the cross and that had been it, that would not have been sufficient. Because many had died and gone to a cross, and there was no life after that. But for Jesus, the Son of God, on the third day he arose bodily, alive. And because he did that, we have redemption and we have salvation and we have the promise of heaven. And I tell you, I would not take anything for this miracle that happened on Sunday morning. Amen. If you have your Bibles in the book of Luke chapter 24, the Word of God, starting with verse 1 down through verse 6, and a part of verse 6 says, "Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. He is alive. Amen. And today, our Savior is alive. We don't serve a dead God. We don't have a dead religion. We've got redemption. We've got life. We've got the promise of life. We've got the promise of a Savior who's always with us, and we've got the promise of an eternal home in heaven. Folks, listen. As bad as this world is, I would just shudder at the very thought to think that I would be facing my eternity without Jesus Christ. I'm glad I'm a born-again, blood-washed child of the King. Heaven's my home, and I'm not ashamed to say I have been born again. Amen. But realizing this without a literal physical resurrection, there's no gospel, there's no Christianity, and there's no hope. But I'm here to tell you accordingly as God's Word declares, and you say, well, you know, just suppose, there's no suppose about this. I can tell you, I'm like Paul of old. I know in whom I have believed and am persuaded that he's able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that I have been washed in the blood and my sins are forgiven and I'm a child of the King. And what Jesus has placed within me, the world can't take out of me. And I've got a promise that he is always for me, with me, and will see me through every valley and trial and every difficulty and every place in life. And he's my God and he's on my side and heaven is my home. I know that because I have received. My life is not the same as Smokey was talking about and singing about earlier in the service today. We stand on the promise of what Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, it's a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. A new life. You could get that today. Some of you have been struggling and trying to find the answers and get through what you're going through, and you've just about beat your head against the wall and you can't sleep at night and you pace the floor and you're taking pills to get you going and pills to put you out, and you're just stressed to the maximum. And you don't know which way to turn. Well, let me introduce you to the one that'll change all of that. And his name is Jesus Christ. When you give your heart and your life to him, he changes it all. Oh, he gives you a peace that will surpass all understanding. He'll be a friend that will stick closer than a brother. He'll never fail you. He'll open doors and he'll shut doors. He'll bless you exceeding abundantly above all that you could ask or think, according to that power, that resurrection power that works within us today and lives and resides there. I've got that promise today. You can have that. And I believe there are many other folks in here, if you're redeemed by the blood of the Lamb this morning and you are not ashamed of the gospel that lives within you, shout amen. Amen. That's three of you. I said, if you're blood-washed, a child of the King, let today the world know who you belong to, shout amen. Amen. That's better. You're not going to a quiet heaven. Some people think, well, I'm just going to heaven. I'm going to sit there and throw my line in the water, catch fish, and just be there in a place of peace and serenity. Buddy, let me tell you what. Heaven is a busy place. It's a loud place. It's a noisy place. It's an active place. It's a praising place. It's a worshiping place. And let me tell you what. I believe the Word of God still says, let the redeemed of the Lord not shut up and sit quiet in a corner. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Amen. So if you today are a child of the King, you've got every reason today to praise him, to worship him, and to thank him for what he has done and what he is doing, and even what he's got in store for you. Amen. Amen. Praise God. So realizing this today, I believe the best news today that the world has ever heard came from a cemetery with two words, he's alive. Amen. Those two words separate Christianity today from every other faith on the face of this earth, because there are a lot of faith movements and faith groups, but unfortunately the focus of their faith is not on a Redeemer, but it's on a mere person today that can't do anything for you. I'm glad today my faith is found in Jesus Christ, and he's done more for me than I ever deserved. But let me tell you, praise the Lord for every blessing he sends. Because he is risen today, we have proof positive that we have eternal life. Do you have that today? See, you're not here today by accident. You're here today by the divine purpose and orchestration of Almighty God. God brought you into this place today and set you in that pew to hear the word of God. And today you know his greatest desire is to change your life. His greatest desire today is to give you heaven. His greatest desire today is to make life meaningful and purposeful for your life. Just not getting by. I'm just hanging on, Pastor. I'm trying to get through. I hear more of that. I mean, I get it on private messages. I get it on emails. I get it on cell phone texts. I get it on phone calls. I haven't tweeted yet. The ducks don't tweet. They quack. Amen. Maybe they'll come up with something that quacks instead. But anyway, that's about all the things that I need to hear from. But realizing this, I believe this story that we have been given accordingly as the pages of God's Word tells us, I believe it's the greatest story that has ever been told, and it's made possible today by the greatest life that has ever been lived, and his name is Jesus Christ. And people in churches today worshiping and praising this God because there is an empty tomb and because there is good news, and the good news is still the gospel, and it's good news from Jerusalem that a Savior is alive and he is seated today in the presence of Almighty God, and he's coming again one day, and we are going home to be with him. Amen. Don't miss the resurrection story. This is just not about Easter bunnies and Easter egg hunts. And this is just not about putting on your pretty clothes and dolling your hair up and looking good. This is about something far greater than all of that. Because sooner or later, that hairspray is going to let go. Amen. And all that twisting and turning you got on your head is going to give way. And all of a sudden, it's just going to go flop. Amen. Thank God the change that he works in us today is a change that never quits, and it's renewed and refreshed every day. Oh, his mercy is anew every day. Great is his faithfulness to us, isn't it? Amen. Don't miss the resurrection story today, because we remember on a Thursday night over 2,000 years ago, Jesus was praying in a place called the Garden of Gethsemane. And that's just outside the walls. I have been there and seen this place. Just outside the walls of the old city of David, Jerusalem. His disciples had slept and they had supposed to be praying. And Jesus had been praying and agonizing in prayer. And the Bible says that his sweat even became as great drops of blood. And it began dripping from his brow. And Jesus was carrying. Listen, he wasn't trying to get out of what he was facing. He had the weight of the world and the sins of all mankind on his shoulders. And he was praying in that garden scene. And it was in agony that he prayed, "Father, not my will, but thine will be done." And be assured, there would come a time, and there will come a time in your life. And you may be in that place in time right now that you're facing a great trial. I know it's Easter, and I know that we celebrate, and I know we thank God, but that doesn't remove the fact that we face trials and circumstances and places in our life that become very trying to our hearts and our lives. And they can become very defeated if you're not careful, and very discouraging, and get us in a place where we're in despair. But let me tell you what, it happened. It happened in God's will today, because God today, through the cross, wants to redeem you. God today wants to turn your life around. God wants to help you. God wants to lift your burdens. When he said you can cast every care on him, he meant that. He cares for you with an everlasting love today. You too will have to declare and come to a point and place in time. You've got to come today and bear your cross. And you too may have to say, "Father, not my will, not what I want. But life gets tough. But thank God, I've got the power of God on me and in me and through me, and he will lift me up. He'll carry me through every obstacle, every defeat, every valley, everything that I face. I've got a God that's for me, and if God didn't be for you, who can be against you?" Amen. Amen. Knowing this today, Jesus bore everything, and thank God Calvary brings a double cure. Knowing today the destiny of Jesus was the cross in our benefit and in our stead. The writer of Revelation proclaims he is the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Had Christ not gone to the cross, consider today, there would not have been any redemption. We would have no hope. And hell would be, because, you know, sooner or later these physical bodies are going to die. But you're going to live forever, one place or the other. Could you imagine if Jesus said, "Forget it, Father, I'm not going to the cross. I'm not going to die. I'm coming back home. Forget it. Let them die. Let them go to hell." Because that's what they deserve. We all were deserving of that. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But God in His love, His mercy and His grace, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life, that God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. See, today we've got to look at our lives and we think, oh man, Easter's so awesome. But, you know, we're back to the grind tomorrow. There's no grind in back to the grind tomorrow. Resurrection lives in your life every day. It's a part of you. It's just not a spring event. It's an everyday event. It's the fact that Christ lives and has redeemed you and your life has been turned around and you've been changed. But you've got to ask this question to yourself today and not try to pull the wool over your own eyes and think, well, I'm doing the best that I can. You know, we've got all the coin phrases that we use about trying to justify our sins, our conditions, our problems, and our circumstances of life. And we try to excuse away everything that we're in. But you've got to come to the realization today, you're either in one or two conditions. You're either saved or you're not. You're either a child of God or you're not. You're either born again or you're not. And see, the only way today that you can be born again is when you come to Christ. You acknowledge your sins. You acknowledge your need of Christ. You recognize He died on the cross for your sins. And you say, God, I know that I'm a wretched sinner. I'm deserving of hell. But I realize that You stepped in my place. You stood up and You nailed and was nailed to the cross. You laid down Your life that I could have life and have it more abundantly. And that You paid my debt in full. You sacrificed Yourself for my sins. Oh God, forgive me of my sin of rejection and coming to my heart and my life. I'm going to tell you on the 2nd of February, 1975, I prayed a prayer like that. And I'm going to tell you right now on the authority of God's Word today that my life has not been the same since. Amen. Lord, have mercy. I'm glad that I'm a blood-washed child of the King. I'm glad that Jesus is my Savior, my elder brother, my friend. I'm glad God is my Father, and I'm glad the devil got kicked out. And praise God, I'm now a child of the King, and heaven is my home, and I have nothing to fear because God is with me and God is for me. Amen. Praise God. As we see from the Scriptures, Jesus went to His disciples. He found them sleeping. And, you know, in the moment that He needed the prayers of His disciples, where did we find them? They were in a position that they were sleeping. They slept. You know, what a reflective of the church today, I'm afraid. Folks, in our greatest hour, when sin seemingly is on the increase and morals have reached an all-time low, and today when men's hearts are hardened and failing them today, and in the darkest spiritual hour, the church is sleeping. We want quiet religion. We want something that creates no change. We want something that will not come with a commitment. It will not come with a sacrifice. We just want to get by. We just want to say, yeah, He's good and thank God for Calvary. But we don't want it to change us. And the problem within the church today is we're not letting Christ change us. We're not getting committed to the cause of Christ. We're not praying today for the lost. We today are not agonizing in prayer for the sick. We're not lifting up those who have fallen. We're not trying today to reach out into our communities and reach them with the cause of Christ. We just want to be quiet, silent, and politically correct. I believe it's time the church rise up and be the people that God's called it to be. We are the voice in the wilderness. We have the hope in our hands today, and it's called the Word of God, and it's time we start proclaiming and living what we say that we believe. If you today profess to be a born-again child of God, then bless God. Start living it. Be a prayer warrior. Be faithful to God's house. Serve the Lord and be faithful to all things that you do to Him. And put your life in a position today that you're seeking the Lord first in all things. Amen. We need an awakening within the church. We need a stirring of the Holy Ghost. We need the power of God to just come down in this room and shake us all up. Get us out of pews of complacency and get us onto altars of commitment. Amen, preacher. Start giving the Lord some praise because God's calling the church to rise up and be the people. Stand to your feet and give this holy God of heaven some praise that is deserving and glorify His name in all things. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord God Almighty. Amen. Be seated. In the Garden of Gethsemane, suddenly there was a flaming torch that came into the company that there was there. And the clamor of the Roman soldiers and the noise. They came to take Jesus. But hallelujah, Rome could not really convict him. The cross could not conquer him. Amen. The grave could not contain him and hold him. And Satan could not defeat him. Amen. Let's not forget who was defeated at Calvary. It was sin, it was death, it was hell, and it was Satan. And it was our own selfish ways. See, you've got to lay down your life and take up the cross and follow Jesus. Glory to God. He was and is and will always be the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. Amen. I don't care if the governments of this world deny it. I don't care if the churches deny it. I don't care if us individually deny it. The fact is, it does not change the fact that God's word says he is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Amen. Praise God. There's no problem you can face today that he cannot solve. There's not a situation, anything that you're going through, because he is the mighty conqueror, and in his presence is victory. Amen. Amen. So why are you living in defeat? Amen. The story contains Jesus was then taken before Pilate, who was very politically correct and very guarding of his position and his authority. So the Pharisees, they really could care less about justice. They just wanted the blood of Jesus. They wanted him on the cross. They wanted him graveyard dead. And in the common hall, the blood of Jesus stained the cobblestone street where they beat him with a cat of nine tails, and his body was just a bloody mass of nothing but torn flesh and blood. He endured that for you and I. Preacher, I thought you was preaching on Easter. That's a part of it. I'm here on this Resurrection Sunday to tell you a miracle happened. A miracle happened. It was called a miracle of redemption, because every drop of blood that he shed was for the remission of our sins. A miracle happened in the cancellation. Glory to God. God did some cancellation at Calvary. Amen. Your sin debt was canceled. Praise the Lord. Your sickness was canceled. With his stripes you're healed. Your habits of addiction were canceled in Jesus' name. Your shame was canceled by the power of Christ. Your condemnation was canceled by the glorious act of dying on the cross for all sinful man. Amen. Jesus did that. And then thirdly, a miracle of restoration, because he will restore you today. Jesus carried his cross. He climbed the bloody slopes of Golgotha, and he was nailed to the cross, and he would bow his bloody soaked head, and he wearing the crown of thorns, and he would declare, "It is finished." Glory to God. Satan and all the demons of hell rejoiced. They thought, well, finally, we have defeated this one that is named as the Son of God. He is dead. He is out of the way. Now let the party begin. Well, let me tell you what. Hold on to the party for a second. Amen. Because what was finished is what we've got to look at. It was not Jesus that was finished. But what was finished was the payment of sin. Finished and paid for in full. Amen. The payment for healing. Finished and paid for in full. The ransom for your children. Finished and paid for in full. How many of you got wayward children? Shout amen. Come on, don't be ashamed of it. How many of you got wayward children that need to get back to God? Say amen. Amen. That ransom was paid for them. The peace for your mind amidst all the toils and trials of life. Finished, paid for in full. The provision for your family. Finished, paid for. The sting of death. Finished, oh death, where's thy sting? Glory. The victory of the grave. Finished, oh grave, where is thy victory? The power of Satan. Finished. You say, yeah, but he goes about as a roaring lion. But let me tell you, there is a standard today. We hold up the blood-stained banner and praise God. We've got a word today called the Word of God that Satan cannot go against. Amen. See, the problem with so many of us is we're taking the Word of God. Oh, we know it, we have it, but we don't use it. We don't apply it to our lives. We say it's a nice book to have to put on the coffee table so it looks nice and pretty. But let me tell you what, it's more than that, friend. It's a book that will change your life. It is a book that will keep away the hounds of hell off of your home, your family, and your life. It's a book that will deliver you. It's a book that will encourage you. It is a book that will lift you up. It is a book today that will provide for your every need. It is a book that is a shelter. It is a book that is a help. It is a book that is a hope. It is a book that will never fail, because this is the precious, inerrant, infallible Word of God. It today stands where everything else has fallen. The Word of God still stands because it's living, it's breathing, it's so hot I can't even hold it, because it holds today the power of Jesus' name in it. Amen. Glory. Woo! Thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. See, redemption is complete. And now there's mercy. There is grace. Where we had no hope, now we have hope. Where there was no forgiveness, now we have forgiveness. Where there was no provision, we now have a provision. Now there is peace. All because a miracle happened on a Sunday morning, that Jesus came out of the tomb and he's alive. Amen. Amen. Glory. Woo! On the cross, there one man died for the sins of the entire whole world. And the Bible says Jesus gave up the ghost. You know, when Jesus accomplished the plan of God on the cross, the sun refused to shine, according to Scripture tells us. As a matter of fact, it's been interpreted this way. It was midnight at midday. It was dark. His blood-soaked body was taken from the cross, wrapped in the cloths, and placed in a tomb. And Jesus laid in a borrowed tomb. It seemed like everything in Jesus' life on this earth was borrowed. He preached from a borrowed boat. He was put in a borrowed tomb. And for 3 days, the giver of life, this provider for every provision, this healer for every broken body, this encourager for every depressed soul, he lay dead. And Satan thought, finally victory has come for our side, the kingdom of darkness. Oh, but I'll tell you, it's strange that if a man is dead and placed behind a sealed stone that sealed the grave, why do they need to put guards there to guard the body of a dead man? Something was stirring, because you know what they had heard? Jesus said, I lay down my life, and if I have the power to lay it down, I have the power to take it up. And he still rolls stones today. Amen? Hallelujah. So the authorities, well, they were glad because he was dead. The disciples, they scattered, kind of like the church today. And Satan was hissing with happiness. He thought he had finally won that victory. And then we see Mary and the mother of Jesus. She is weeping, and something began to happen, and there was a strange feeling in the air. Oh, have you ever been in the presence of the power of God, and you knew something was moving? You couldn't explain it with words, but you just knew seemed like the presence of God was just coming and hovering above you and beneath you and around you and touching you, and all of a sudden you just felt God doing something. The Word of God says that this feeling filled the air, and he said, listen, oh, the power of God was about to move. Jesus actually arose in the dark. See, we think, well, it had to be a bright sunny morning and Jesus didn't get up out of the grave until the sun came up. No, that's not actually scripturally correct. The gospel records the women discovered the empty tomb around daybreak. So I believe that he arose during the dark. They arrived at the tomb just before sunrise. And Mark records very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. And this means that they began that journey to the gravesite, to this borrowed tomb. And when they arrive, oh my God, something has happened. The body of Jesus is gone. Oh, but you know, those who walked with him heard the words, and all of a sudden those words became real in their life.